As you know, we're looking at the book of Romans. That shouldn't take you by surprise. We're in Romans chapter 3. And this evening we'll be looking verses 27 to 31. I don't know if we'll be able to finish it. And the good news, if I'm not able to finish it, we have until Jesus comes to finish this sermon series. So I am pretty excited about it. Amen. So let's get to reading God's word. Romans 3, 27 to 31. And I just want to remind you of how Romans sets out. It tells us that the Gentiles are sinners. You know, by definition, Gentiles would be anyone outside of the covenant, the Abrahamic covenant. And so all Gentiles, he says, you know what? All of you Gentiles, you're all sinners. And then it tells us that it's not just Gentiles that are sinners. The Jews are also sinners. So all of us, as argued by Paul, we're all sinners. And then it tells us that the wrath of God is real. And if we don't fix it, or if it's not fixed, that there's some hot days coming. And then all of a sudden, Paul gives us some hope. And he tells us that Jesus Christ made a way. Jesus became the sacrifice. He would be the one that would take on the wrath of God. He would stand in place, and he would be the one that would take on the sins of the world. And I like the way Paul argues. Paul is trained legally, so he's a legal profession. And I like the way he argues, because from 27 to 31, what he will set out to do is explain to us why the Lord God will do what he did, why he will bring salvation to all of us, why he will justify us. And it's just amazing, because I like the way God does what he does. And so let us read from 27. Just gonna pull this out, so I'm not looking back. All right, so I'll make sure I get you out of here on time for those of you who need to see basketball or hockey or family dinner or whatever you need. We're going to make sure I get you out on time. So 27. Then what becomes of our boasting? It is excluded. By what kind of law? By a law of works? No, by a law of faith. For we hold that one is justified by faith apart from the works of the law. Or is God the God of Jews only? Is he not the God of Gentiles also? Yes, of Gentiles also, since God is one who will justify the circumcised by faith and the uncircumcised through faith. Do we then overthrow the law by this faith? By no means. On the contrary, we uphold the law. I read it first and I go, this is a pretty complex piece of argument, but it's when you take some time and you read, you realize it's not as complex as it appears. Because what Paul sets out is he will ask six questions in total, and he's making essentially three points. And I just want you to see just for a sermon outline so that you're following what it is that Paul is essentially arguing. And most commentators will basically argue that there are mainly three issues at play here. One is that he's talking about justification by faith alone excludes all boasting. And he's looking, these commentators are arguing from 27 to 28, that's what Paul is going to set out in this argument. And the second thing is that God is one. We have one God, and it's this one God that will justify all people, and not by works. And three, that justification by faith does not nullify the law, but rather establishes it. And I don't know if we'll get to three. I'm going to leave that for Pastor John, I think, because of time. But let's get into the Word of God. Justification by faith alone. And this is what we're talking about. And Paul sets out and he asks, who could we, how, who can boast about this saying? He says, no, boasting is excluded. And why is he doing it? Because he's saying that justification by faith alone excludes all boasting. Now, not all boasting is bad, is it? You boast about your wife, don't you? Of course. If you're smart, you'll do it. People boast about their kids. Different people boast about different things. And so it's not abnormal to boast in something. So here are a couple of examples of boasting in the Bible. 2 Corinthians, Paul is, you know, he's writing and he says, for I know your readiness, of which I boast about you. So he was boasting about this church. Or another example, Galatians 6:14, Paul says, you know, he's saying, I don't want to think about all these different things, you know. I can boast in all of these things that I've done, because he was a Jew of Jews, you know. He was a member of the Sanhedrin. He was a brilliant author, brilliant writer, trained in the arts. He was very scholarly, and he kept the law from a child. He actually argues that he never broke the law. And then he argues, I could boast in all that stuff, but I don't think it makes sense. I choose to boast in the cross. And so Paul sets out that, so we know for a fact that not all boasting is bad. So third one is Jeremiah 9:23-24. Thus saith the Lord, let not the wise man boast in his wisdom. Let not the mighty man boast in his might. Let not the rich man boast in his riches, but let him who boasts boast in this, that he understands and know me. Now, you ever know people who say, I understand the Bible? And so Jeremiah says, and he sets it plain, he says there's a difference between understanding God and knowing God. But he's saying that we should boast in the fact that we understand God and we know him. That God is a God of steadfast love. He practices justice and righteousness in the earth. So not all boasting is bad. So what then is Paul really talking about? What is he upset about? Now, Jesus talks about boasting, and what Paul is directing his comments to in this particular context is to the Jews of the day. Because they saw themselves as superior to the other Christians in the church. They knew that they were Jews and they had Gentiles in the church. And so they boasted about the fact that they were children of Abraham. And this was an actual issue that Jesus himself confronted in Matthew 23-24. It will read, woe to you scribes and Pharisees. For you tithe mint and dill and cumin, you have neglected the weightier matter of the law. You've did all of these things. You've kept all of these ceremonial duties. As a matter of fact, the Jews were so specific, they would count the leaves, and every tenth one, they would put it aside for tithes. They were very, very strict about observing the law. And, you know, they would boast in that. And Jesus looks at them and says, woe to you. You do all of these things. You come to church on Saturday night. You read your Bible. You wake up. You pray. You do all of these things, but you neglect the weightier matters of the law: justice, mercy, faithfulness. I could preach a whole sermon on those three things: there. Justice, mercy, faithfulness. And so, Jesus is actually making a case against them. In other parts of the Bible, he will look at them and he will call them white-walled sepulchres. I thought, when I first read it, I'm like, that's not a real, in our society, that's not a disrespectful thing to say. But then I think about it, you're telling a person that they're nasty on the inside. Because that's what he called them, whitewashed sepulchres. You know, they're not even painted nice, just whitewashed, and inside they're filled with dead men's bones. And so Jesus himself condemns the Jews for their boasting, because his argument is that they ignore the weightier things. And Paul also makes a case. As a matter of fact, Paul makes a case in the earlier scriptures in 17. He says, And this one was an indirect attack on the Jews. You know, when he was building his case, he says, but if you call yourself a Jew and rely on the law and boast in God. So he was setting them up. He didn't bring the hammer down as yet. But if we look at the second verse in 23, he says, you who boast in the law, dishonor God by breaking the law. So Paul is directing his attack. He is basically writing this part of Romans, and he's addressing the Jews. And he's addressing them because he has found them to be dishonest. He is saying to them, you guys boast, but I don't know if you have a right to boast. I don't know if you have something to be really proud of. So why the emphasis? Why is Paul making the statement that he's making? And Paul is making this statement because from personal experience and from scripture, we realize that man by nature is broken. And we like to take credit for things that we oftentimes shouldn't be taking credit for. And so Paul is setting up his argument, and he's telling them before we get to the part where Jesus will come and he will save and he will talk about salvation and about justification, he's going to tell them up front, this thing will happen, and all that you have done, none of what you have done actually, you can stand before God and say, it's because of this, this is why you do what you do. So Paul knows that we often like to take credit for things that we don't deserve. We like to take credit for the work that the Savior did. Here's an example. I don't know if you know the name Stanley King. Stanley King was a basketball player. And in a playoff game, Michael Jordan scored 69 points, which was typical of Michael Jordan. And Stanley King scored once. This was Stanley King's assessment of the game. This is how we view the game. He's like, you know what? Between Michael Jordan and I, we combined for 70 points. Now, of course, Stanley was joking. Stanley was not, he was just trying to be hilarious. But the point is made. Because of our own nature, we have this propensity to boast in things. And Paul is smashing that argument from the get-go. He is making sure that we know that nothing that God has done, nothing about salvation is for our credit. As a matter of fact, as religious people, you know, we're religious. We come to church, we do all of these things. And there's that assumption, because we come to church, because we pay tithes, because we help in the nursery, because we work, we volunteer, we clean the church, we fill the tank, we do stuff, that this is why God saved us. There must have been something about you. Yep. He must have liked something about you to have saved you. Don't you think so? No, but I mean, if we put aside all the religious thing, there must be something that you think that you're good at, and that's why God saved you. You had a voice that you could sing. You knew how to memorize scripture. You were tall. You could go into places and do things and not be intimidated. You had nice hair, or you could run long distances. There must be a reason why God chose me. There must be some good in me that, you know. And Paul is setting out. He's like, that's not what God is doing. But we set, don't we do that as human beings? We make arguments. We think about it. Now, we oftentimes, and that's how boasting works. We can see a person who's boastful. Don't like Trevor, man. Trevor boasts all the time. But we don't see it in ourselves. Not all boasting is bad again, but this thing actually occurs. So here's something that I recognize. Why the emphasis? We like to boast because we think there is something in us that God saw. And Paul is saying, well, we can't even boast in our religious observance as a means of salvation, because that's not why God saved us. As a matter of fact, we can't even boast that we have spiritual knowledge. Here's what the scripture tells us in Romans 3:11. There is none who understands. There is none who seek for God. There is none who understands. Isn't that a strong statement? Especially if you spent 4 years in Bible school, and then you did your master's, and you decide, I'm going to go on and do my PhD. And then Roman tells you, you know what? Paul's like, no, none of you understand. So Paul is basically destroying the idea that we did something in our lives or will do something in the future, and that is why God justifies us by faith. As a matter of fact, this undeserved gift that God gives us is something that we can't boast about. Let's look at Ephesians 2, 8 to 9. It says, by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing. It is a gift of God, not a result of your works, so that no one may boast. And he makes the, I mean, this is another piece, another writing that Paul will make the point again. But in Romans 3:28, he makes the point. He's saying, for we hold that one is justified by faith apart from the works of the law. There is nothing that you did in your past. Have you ever heard people say, the reason why I'm in church is because my grandmother prayed for me? Oh, no. The reason why you're in church is because God saw it fitting. How many of you had grandmothers that didn't pray, but you were in church? My grandmother prayed, but to the wrong God. But we like to think that there must be a reason. And Paul is destroying. I thought about this thing, and the reason why I'm seeing it often is because I believe as children of God, because we have spent all these years in the kingdom, that we firmly believe that there is something in us that God liked. Here is damning truth for all of us. When God looked down on you and decided to save you, there was nothing about you that he liked. Not your nice hair, the way you parted it, not the way you tucked in your shirt. It wasn't the plaid. It wasn't the way it matched your pants. It wasn't the way you held your glasses. There was nothing about it. God didn't like your necklace. God didn't like your hairstyle. God didn't like your color. I'm tempted to say that God didn't like you, but that's not true. God loves us, but he didn't like the nature in you, the sin nature. There was nothing about you that made God look down the road and go, you're going to be a preacher. I better save this one. He did none of that because that's not how he worked. Because if he had done that, we would have been able to stand in the church and testify, my grandmother prayed for me and that's why I am here. Boasting. Because we want to be able to look back at our lives, look back in our past, maybe even look into our future and say, God knew what he was doing. God saved me. I'm sure Evan goes home going, God saved me, I'm a pastor's son. He didn't want John to look bad. So he saved me. He had to do it. He gave me a voice. He gave me a good wife. I know, I still think you paid her, but that's another story for another day. Nothing that we did deserves the faithfulness of God. And I want you to hear that. Because I think as a people we have fooled ourselves and we have been fooled to think that we did something and that's why God did what he did. Nothing about it. So that none of us may boast. Now, the problem with the way Paul makes this argument, because Paul is going to say that we are justified by faith apart from the works of the law, we run into a conflict. Now, there is a conflict between Paul and James. I don't know if you know. Take a look. This is what's going on. There's a conflict. There's a war. There's a challenge between Paul and James. First one. No, not that Paul. That's Paul Pierce and LeBron James. No, not that one. No, that's James Harden and Chris Paul. Not those ones. No, that's Paul George, man. We're missing it. And I want to apologize to you. Those are not the things we're talking about, but I don't have any NHL examples, so I just put basketball ones up. And my wife said, go Leafs, because she's from Toronto. But there's a conflict between what Paul will argue and what we will find in James, and I want to show you that. James sets out, and he says, you see that a man is justified by works and not by faith alone. And I'm like, what? What's wrong with this James, brother? Because Paul is arguing, for we hold that no one is justified by faith apart from the works of the law. So we have two camps, and these two camps is one of the reasons why the church is split. The church is split because the Roman Catholics will contend that we are justified by faith plus our works, as James seems to affirm. And then Protestants, Luther and Calvin, they will argue, no, this thing is faith alone. This is faith alone. We are justified by faith apart from the works. So we have a conflict here. Do you see it? Do you see it? This thing has split churches. They fought wars over this. People were burned and beaten and all that stuff because of this issue of works. You know that? I was like, what? You kill people because you're not sure if we're justified by faith and works together? We killed people because there was a conflict between two camps about how does this thing work. And I want to take some time to look at it for you. Now, what is James arguing? You see, James was looking at those who profess to have faith. And I'm going to bring the hammer here a little bit, so just bear with me. I'm going to make sure I cover it a little bit of velvet so it doesn't strike too hard. James is looking at people, Christians who profess to have faith in Christ, but their lives were void of works. Do you know anyone like that? Don't raise your hand. Don't raise your hand. Mark, stop pointing at Evan. That's not good. That's what James is essentially arguing. He's also contending. He claims that some sort of faith was not genuine and does not save anyone. That sort of faith where you believe or you say you believe, but there's no works that goes along with it. Because James is contending essentially that genuine saving faith always results in a life of good work. Good work, life of good works. So James is saying, you know what, John, you can't tell people that you're a Christian and you're breaking into the neighbor's garage and stealing their fuel. John doesn't do that, by the way. He gets the guys to do it for him. No, just kidding. That's essentially what James is arguing, that you cannot do this thing. But so James' focus is not that you will be saved by your works. He is saying that you cannot claim to be a Christian. You cannot claim faith. And that your works are messed up. You get me? You can't claim to be a Christian and you treat people badly because you don't know them, or you have no compassion for the poor. Paul is saying that sort of faith, that sort of thing doesn't work. It's not genuine. Are you seeing that? James is not trying to tell us that we need to do works in order for God to save us. He's telling us we're saved by faith. We're justified by faith. But after we have been justified by faith, that there's a concomitant sort of response. There's something that comes after it. And that response is we behave like Christians. And he's not saying that we should be perfect, but he's looking at our works. And James was a hard brother. Look at what Paul is essentially arguing. It's essentially the same thing. You see, Paul was writing to those who taught that we needed to add faith to works in order to be saved. Because in, as I said, in that time of the day, in that time in the church, the Jews would say to the Gentiles, brother, you need to go get snipped. And for those of you who don't get that, brother, you need to go get circumcised. No, Trevor, you're okay. Sorry, Jesus said you don't need to. It's okay. Don't panic. Because if that were a prerequisite, I don't know if I would have been a Christian. And Paul sets it out. He's saying, when you do this, what you are doing is that you are making your works equal with the work of God. See, that right there is the danger in being justified by faith and works. Is that you are telling God that my offering and my tithes and the fact that I visited the poor equates with the sacrifice that you made by leaving heaven, loving me, a sinful person, dying on a cross. Isn't that presumptuousness? And that's why C.S. Lewis will argue that boasting is one of those sins that cause all of these other things to spiral out of control. He sees it as a root. C.S. Lewis will argue that if you're a boastful person, the fact that you will do certain things is because you're boastful, because you see yourself in a certain light. You ever had a conversation with someone who you know that they're looking down on you? You get the sense. You're having a conversation, but there's something going on here. Someone said to me the other day, say, hey, how are you doing? We're having this conversation. He's like, so how will you do this thing that you said you're going to do? I look at her, I go, you know what, Wainwright, don't answer her. Just walk away. Because it's pride. Because we see it in people, but it's also in us. And Paul destroys that, and instead of us boasting in our works, he gives us an alternative. He says, if you want to boast in anything, if you want to boast in anything, boast in the cross. Boast in the fact that God loved me, that Jesus died for me, that the cross was the reason why I am here. Not me, not my works, not what I did in the past, not because grandma prayed, none of those things. And I want to jump ahead because I know we're running out a bit of time, and we'll elaborate a little bit about this. We'll expound, we'll pull some things out as months and years expire. But the church also had an issue, is that the Jews knew that they were the children of God. And God had told them that. The Bible tells us, in Exodus 6:7, because what Paul is doing is he's anticipating that when he will say to them that you are not saved by works, that the Jews will go, wait a minute, you are probably saying that we are equal with that man over there. Because that's what he's going to say. And Paul is anticipating that this thing will come up. He is anticipating that the Jews will be upset. John, the Jews are going to be upset because the black man and the white man and the Chinese man and the First Nation brother all sat in the same bench. And Jesus loved each and every one of them the same way. Paul is contending, he's anticipating that a Jew will stand up and go, we are not all the same. One of us is a little different because one of us is special. Because they knew that in Exodus 6:7, the Lord God said to them, I will take you to be my people, and I will be your God, and you shall know that I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt. Whose God are we talking about? The Jews' God, because that's what it says there. Or Jeremiah says, and you shall be my people, and I will be your God. But the Jews, like a lot of people, didn't read the full thing. They cherry-picked the scriptures to see what God was talking about. And so Paul is going to destroy the idea that they were somehow special, and it is as a result of the covenant of Abraham. It is a result of the... It was based on the fact that Jehovah God loved them, that Abraham was their father. That is why they were going to be justified by faith. The works of Abraham, it was because they were special. And they were going to say to Paul, we don't buy this thing. We hear the argument that you're making. But the book tells us, the book tells us that he is our God. So the Gentiles must do something to become like us. That's why we're going to take you and circumcise you. Because that's how you become a part of the covenant. And Paul is going to squash that really quickly. This is what Paul is going to argue. And I want you to know the tactfulness of Paul. He says, or is God the God of Jews only? Is he not the God of the Gentiles? Yes, of Gentiles also, since God is one. See, what he has done is that he is saying, you cannot claim that he is your God, and he is not my God, but he will claim that he saved all of us. Because if you do that, then you are making him to be different gods. A God of the Jew and a God of the Gentiles. And the Jews would never utter the words that would seek to suggest that there's multiple gods. Their creed was, hear, O Israel, the Lord is one. And they were going to struggle with the creed if they suggested that God would save the Gentiles and then he would save the Jews and there would be different gods. And so Paul destroys the argument in a single sentence. He asks the question, is he God of the Gentiles or is he God of the Jews? Well, he's actually one God. And it is the same God who will justify the circumcised, which will be the Jew, and the uncircumcised through faith. When Pastor John gets here, because running out of time, he will expound a little bit more, and I'm probably setting him up a little bit here. But I want you to notice the way God justifies the circumcised. He will justify them by faith, and the uncircumcised he will justify through faith, two different processes. And Pastor John, in his scholarly manner, will elaborate and make all of us feel, wow. We don't have the time to go there, and I want to leave this with you. We are justified by faith apart from the works of the law for a single reason. What is our reason? So that none of us can boast. None of us can say that we did something or we deserved in some way, shape, or form to be saved, to be justified by faith. And Paul will also argue that this justification is for both Jew and Greek. And he will argue that, and this is why it's important that it's for both categories, or some translations will tell you it's for all. He will argue it because the wrath of God is revealed against all unrighteousness and against all ungodliness. And so if the justification is only for one group of people, then there's a group of individuals who will experience the wrath of God because somehow God chose a particular people to be his people. And this is why Paul skillfully weaves through the arguments that the Jews are likely to ask, and he makes these two key observations. in the end, the main point is that we are justified by faith alone, apart from works. Would you stand with me?